Hello, this is the Provoked Prawn, and this is the Corsair 7000D Airflow. This is a full tower ATX case from Corsair, which obviously has a focus on airflow, and as you can see, has the potential to have a multitude of fans in it, and a really nice aesthetic. It's a really interesting case, and this hopefully will be an equally interesting video. But first, some peel. Now don't worry, there'll be some more of that later on. Now this video is a very in-depth look at this case and the setup process for the installation that you've just seen and the end result of that. But I'm also going to talk to you about all the different things that you can do with this case, the various features and facets of it, and all the highlights and lowlights of the design. I'm going to show you how to set up in it and talk to you about the various aspects of that. And hopefully that will be useful if you're considering purchasing it, or if you have purchased it and want to know how to set it up and what you should do with it and what the best course of action is. Now, I've previously looked at the 4000D Airflow and the 5000D Airflow, and I have videos separately on those that I'll link to in the description in case you're interested in checking it out. The 4000D I found a bit fiddly to install, and the 5000D was very flexible, and the 7000D is even better. Obviously, being a full tower case, it is rather large. As you will have seen from the box, there's a warning on the side of that that says it's 15 kilos and needs to be carried by two people, who obviously don't lift because it isn't that heavy. But the overall thing is quite a chunky beast and will take up a lot of room on your desk, and it is quite hefty when you've got everything else installed in it. But what it does offer is a multitude of angles for air and cooling, as well as a really nice view into the case. And more importantly, a lot of flexibility. So it comes installed with two 140mm fans on the front and one 140mm fan on the rear, but you can install up to 12 120mm fans, seven 140mm fans, or you can install three 360mm radiators on it, or two 420mm rads. So there's loads of potential installation options here, and a really flexible design. Now there are a number of doors. Obviously the front panel has a tempered glass finish, and at the rear you can take off these two doors and have access to the cable area where you're going to be cable tidying and setting everything up. Here's a front view of those 140mm fans. These are airflow fans, and I did a video previously on the 5000D where I showed that you can actually use those fans on their own and get pretty good performance out of them. They're designed for maximum airflow. Obviously, they don't have any RGB lighting, but if you want to just use those fans when you initially get the case and not worry about any other fans, then you can do it. It is potentially something that you can do. There was really good airflow in the 5000D, and I'd imagine there would be in the 7000 as well, because of the overall design is basically the same. You also have a number of different areas where you can mount fans. You'll see a standard, for example, there's a rear panel which is basically a cable hiding area that basically allows you to either keep that sort of cover there, or you can side mount some fans. So behind where that panel is at the moment, you basically have an area that hides your cables and an area that blocks that section off. At the front, you obviously have those two 140mm fans, but you can take that fan tray off. And that is one of the highlights of that that I'll show you as I go through, that there are removable trays in here for the installation of the fans that make the setup really nice. You'll also see the other highlights. For example, you have a see-through area for the PSU, so you can see into that and access this. Now the overall aesthetic of the 7000D is very similar to the 4000D and the 5000D. You have this airflow section on the front. All of the things are removable, and there are multiple different dust covers that are held in place with magnets, and they're really easy to get off. And this is something that I've always loved about Corsair cases. They're really well thought out in terms of the airflow design and those sort of shields for preventing dust and dirt getting into your case. So you can see when you take that front cover off, you have a really large fine mesh anti-dust filter thing in the front there that you can just take off really easily. And that doesn't impact those front fans either. So as standard, you have these large 140mm fans, and they are installed with a PWM controller. So the initial setup of it, if you don't actually use any of the fans, is really, really simple, because they're already plugged into the controller for you. And then you just need to plug that controller into your motherboard and SATA power. And I'll talk to you a bit about that as we go through. On the top, you have a similar sort of setup. Again, another dust tray and really easy access to that. Another thing that you'll note is there are multiple USB ports on the front panel. So you have USB 3.1 type C ports and four USB 3 ports on the top there, as well as combination audio jack, the reset button and the power button. You will need to make sure you have the right sort of motherboard in order to make the most of this, because the one I'm using for this build doesn't actually have enough USB headers on it in order to give you access to all of those USB ports on the front. Something to bear in mind if you're considering purchasing the case: make sure you've got a motherboard that actually has two USB connections, and I'll show you that later on as well. One of the most fantastic things about the design, as I said, is the removable trays. So on the top, for example, there's one that is held in place with two thumb screws. And you notice there's obviously no fans installed on here as standard, but you have the ability to install a multitude of fans. I'm going to be installing a 420mm radiator from the Corsair H170i Elite Capellix cooler, which I'm going to do a video on separately, but I'll show you the setup process for that and talk about it briefly in here. And you can see that that tray is going to make life a lot easier. The front tray also removes, although it is worth noting, as I said, that those fans are already installed and connected to the PWM controller in the back. So removing a couple of screws on there and you can get access to that. But then obviously they're still held in place with those cables, so you need to make sure you look at that. Now, the manual for this actually talks you through all the various things that you can remove. And you'll see when you get to the rear, for example, that side panel, the rear panel here at the back, is removable too. And that, again, that is another fan tray. Removing that also gives you access to be able to take off the cable cover and that front bit. So there are multiple sections and a number of different screws that you need to remove in order to do that. You can see you can take that off. Once you remove those covers, you'll see that there are two trays at the bottom that allow for the installation of six standard platter hard drives, six 2.5-inch or 3.5-inch drives that can be installed at the bottom there. You'll also see that you have access to three SSD drive trays there that can be mounted on the rear, and you can also install another one just behind the CPU. There's a bracket specifically for that, so you have a multitude of options when it comes to the installation of storage within the case, which gives you loads of flexibility. And there's even more that come later on. It's also worth noting that you can move and remove those hard disk drive cages as well, and I'll show you how to do that a bit later. But what you're seeing now is that there are a number of different things that you can do to this case to change the look and feel of it and the overall design of it. Another thing that you can do is you can remove this front tray that's at the bottom. So as standard, it obviously hides one of those hard disk drive cages, and you can see that hides that away nicely. Now, if you're installing front fans on there, obviously you've got those fans blowing directly onto the cage, which is quite nice because it will keep your drives running cool. And you have easy access to be able to take that out, install your drives, put them back in, and basically a simple setup. Another alternative that you get in the box is you have a different plate that you can put on the front here. So if you're not going to have that drive tray in there and you want a slightly neater look and feel to it, you can install this one that hides away some of the rear and makes for a cleaner design. So it allows you to customize the look and feel of it and change it the way you want. These are all held in place with thumb screws, so it's really easy to switch between them and set it up the way you want to really easily as well. There's so many different options for installation in this thing. It's incredible. You can see once you take that tray out that the front is very clean. Nice large access point. As I said, as standard you get those 240mm fans, but I'm going to install four 120mm ML120 RGB Pros on the front and at the side as well. So having a lot of airflow coming in for intake, pulling air into the case and flowing through. Now, a quick shot from above of what you can do with that. And what basically what I'm going to do is I'll take this tray back out and I want to show you what you can do with the hard disk drive trays, because they're R2 and you can mount them in different ways, so you do have the options to do it. Obviously you can take them out completely, which gives you a freedom for both sort of overall aesthetic and for more cable management, and I'll show you what I mean by that in a minute. But basically they just slide into place and hook in there, and then they're held down with thumb screws. There's a lot of different screws and thumb screws that go on in this case, but it's fairly easy to set up, remove and reinstall things the way you want to. Now, at the rear, you'll see there obviously is a section for your power supply. As I said, you can see there's a see-through panel for that. There's another panel included in the box. If you don't want to use that, you can swap it out. Corsair also says that you could potentially make your own if you're interested. Now, I have the RM850 power supply here, and I've put my cables in already to try and make life a bit easier. But what I want to demonstrate is that it's pretty difficult to get the power supply in while the tray's there with the cables plugged in. So there's not a great deal of room with that hard disk drive cage in the way, but you can really easily take that out. And that is something that's been nice on the 4000, 5000D, is the ability to remove these if you don't want to use them. Previously on the other models, it didn't give you much options in where you could install it otherwise. You could move it a bit further forward on the 5000D. They've done the same sort of thing here on the 7000. So if you want to, you can move it right to the front of the case instead, which gives you a lot more room in terms of the space for your power supply unit, which also makes installation a lot easier, and it makes it a lot easier to hide your cables, which I'll show you later on. Another nice thing that you can do is that you can stack these cages. So if you remove this little bracket that sits on the bottom of this one that would normally hold it in place onto the case itself, you can then slot it on top of the other one, so you can stack them. So if you do want to have loads of storage, if for some reason you want six traditional hard drives in your machine because you have a lot of storage for some reason, then you can easily do that. You can see that they just clip into place, and then you can just screw it down to hold it down. You then actually have really easy access potentially to run the cables from those, the SATA cables and the power cables, both to your power supply and to the motherboard, because it's a very short distance, and because of the nature of the case, it's particularly easy to hide the cables. You'll see there's a lot of areas for hiding the cables, and I'll show you more of that later on. Now, as I said, there are three trays for installing SSD drives as well. So if you have a 2.5 inch SSD, for example, I have Samsung's 860 Pro here that I've been using for a while. You can basically just slot those in, screw them in. You get all the screws that are required in the motherboard box. At the beginning of the video, you're seeing there was a cardboard tray that was included inside the box. You can get that out, and then that has all the screws that you need. It's got motherboard screws, SSD screws, and loads of other things included in it. So you can basically screw that in and then hook this back into place, and then obviously run your SATA cables round to where you want them. So you have potential for installing three there, and there's a tray that sits behind the motherboard just above where my right hand is now that you can also install another one on potentially. So there's loads of options for storage, a ridiculous amount of storage options here actually, and it's a lot more flexible, because if you do want that storage but you also want space for your power supply unit, it's possible. You can also take those trays and you can move them to the front, so you can see here, I'm just doing it to show you how to do it, there is room to install three of them on the front instead low down, which is an interesting option and potentially gives you the chance to show your drives off if you want to, but also to keep them cooler because the air is obviously going to be blowing from the front intake fans over them. Now at the rear, one of the highlights almost certainly is this double door system. You can remove that inner door and take it off and get a bit easier access to it. It makes building a lot easier, and it's also fantastic for hiding away your cable shame, which I will show you at the end, because I've purposely not made the cables super tidy because I want to demonstrate just what you can do with them. The RM850 installs nice in here, and also thanks to that overall aesthetic of this, it really looks the part in here, and you see a glimpse of it through the front. Now, there is an RGB power supply unit that Corsair did. Unfortunately, I've not ever seen that, but I reckon that would look good in here. You can make the most of the RGB lighting. Now, the 7000D holds a lot of the same sort of design as the 5000D in terms of the channeling for your power supply cables, and makes it really easy to hide that stuff away. Here you can see a close-up with a PWM controller. So as standard, it has the three fans plugged into it, and then you just basically need to plug your SATA power connection into your power supply unit, and then the other connection goes to a system fan header on your motherboard. At the bottom, you have all the front panel connections, the USB-C and the standard USB connection, and then your power and reset button switches. And then you'll note that there are two USB connections for the front panel because there's so many front panel connections on this. So that's what I was talking about in terms of making sure you have the motherboard that can support that, otherwise you're going to have problems. Now, to demonstrate what you can do with the channeling of the cables, you've got the 24-pin power supply cable here that runs onto the motherboard. I'm obviously going to run that up the side And I'm using the Velcro ties that are included in the box. Now you have these ones as included in standard, but there's actually some more with that Corsair logo on it. And you can run them on the right hand side as well. And it allows you to tighten things up without using the plastic ties, which I think is really important because it basically means that you can ensure that everything's set up the way you want it and kind of neat while you're going through the process. What I like to do is make sure I've finalized before I use plastic ties and make things a bit more permanent. Now here you can see the Corsair H170i, which is a 420mm cooler that comes with 340mm RGB fans. And it obviously is a magnificent beast in terms of the amount of cooling potential that it offers. I'm going to do a separate video on this where I'll go into a lot more depth on it, but I'm also going to include the benchmarks in the description for what I got out of this cooler and out of the case in general, so you can get an idea of the airflow potential on it. And I'll talk to you a bit more about that later on. The setup for this is basically I'm going to use this as my exhaust, so you'll note that by the end of it I'll have one exhaust fan on the rear, but I'm also going to be using these 340mm fans to exhaust through the radiator. So I'm going to have 8 fans on the front for intake and 3 on the top exhausting through this 420mm radiator, and hopefully keeping the CPU nice and cool, and I can tell you it does keep cool under pressure as well. The installation for this is really straightforward. Basically, I have worked out the direction I want the pump to face, and then obviously ensuring that while I'm installing the fans, the cables for them are going to be facing the rear of the case, because there are 2 cables per fan that need to be set up. So you have power and RGB lighting for those fans. And so you need to ensure that you have the right amount of length in them. I thought about which way around I wanted the pump tubes to go. I considered putting it so it was at the rear, but thought it might interfere with the exhaust fan. And the other option is at the front. Obviously, there is potential for side mounting the radiator instead. As I said, there are a number of different options of what you can do with mounting the radiators. As I say, you can have 3 360mm rads installed in here, or 2 420mm. So you could front mount, you could side mount, you can top mount. The options are limitless. Well, I wanted to set it up in the way that was basically intaking loads of cold air through the front and then exhausting hot through the back and the rear. And this is the way I went about it. So the installation of this thing is really easy. The long screws go into the top through the fans and into the radiator. Dead simple setup process. The cabling for this thing is also really easy. It has a commander core, which is basically a control box that allows for power and RGB. And you connect them in sequence. So you connect fan 1 on the RGB side and then on the power side, you can see here. And then fan 2 goes in the number 2 slots and fan 3 in the other slots. Now, usually you can use the commander core or commander pro to connect all your fans up. But I'm not doing that in this case, and I'll talk to you about that a bit more. But that's basically because I'm using 140mm fans on the rad and 120 elsewhere on the case, and I didn't want to mix and match. So the fan setup actually becomes a bit more complicated as we go through, but I'll talk to you about that. Now, this cooler is also awesome because you can remove that front plate and you can swap it out. There's 2 plates included in the box. You have a black one, you have a white one. You can also custom print your own as well, which is another option. So if you want to create your own designs, you can do that and fit a 3D printed plate to the front of this to create an interesting customized look and feel to it. This cooler will also work with both Intel and AMD. I'm using an AM4 socket. It's a AMD 5900X CPU, and I'll include all the specifications, everything I'm doing, in the description so you can find out more about that if you're interested on the overall setup. And as I said, there will be benchmarks included in that description as well, so you can see what the performance was like of the cooler and the case in general, because I'm also going to be doing a vertical mounting, and that's something I want to talk about as well a bit later on why, the implications of that and also the options for it, because again, there are multiple options in what you can do with the setup. It's a very flexible case, and this cooler is also really easy to set up. It's one of the easiest I've done, and also offers potentially a hell of a lot of cooling. The other thing that's wonderful about it is because of the removable fan tray that's on the top, again, another removable tray, it's really easy to install onto that tray and then install into the case too. So obviously we are taking that tray off and then we are mounting the rad directly onto it. We're basically making sure that we have things facing in the right direction on that tray. And the logic of it, again, I'm going to set it up so that the cables go to the back, because obviously you want to minimize the amount of mess. Now, in order to do this, I basically just worked it off the edge of my desk and then set it up. So I installed the rad on it and used the little screws with the washers on them that are included in the case. Now, on the previous Elite Capellix cooler video that I did, I mentioned about how they include enough screws to do push-pull in the box, which is a really nice setup. They did the same thing with this one as well. So if you want to, you could potentially install push-pull setup with multiple fans. So you could maybe install fans on the top of this as well, and underneath and on top, and potentially increase the cooling even more. Unfortunately, I didn't have another 340mm fans that I could use, and I didn't want to try and mix and match 120mm with 140mm. I didn't think it would work terribly well or look that great, so it's not something I've done this time, but I did do push-pull with the 5000D if you're interested in finding out how to set that up. So once you've got the rad mounted, it's then just a case of plopping it inside. What I did find is that I had mine installed a little too far forward, and so that I couldn't convince the tray to go back into place. But because of this way this is set up, it's really easy to sort that out. So I initially just dropped it down into place, tried to screw it back down, but it wouldn't go. It wouldn't sit in the... And there's a couple of little notches that go into the holes there that then hold it in place. So what I had to do was then basically loosen all the screws on top in order to shift the tray just a little bit. And that actually was really easy as well, and it saves for a lot of hassle. Once you have that in place, you can also move the cables. There's a lot of nice holes at the top of the case, which are easy to access so that you can run the cable into the back really easily. And I will show some close-up shots of it later on so you can see just how easy the cable management is. So here we are at the early stages of the installation process still, obviously, but I have the radiator mounted and you can see what's going on here, the cabling. But you can also see some of the holes that I was talking about at the top. Because it's a full tower case, it's dead simple to install. The next thing that I'm doing is I'm taking the two 140mm fans that are on the front fan tray and I'm going to install four 120mm, so the ML120 Pro RGB fans, I'm going to be installing them in the place. But here you can see the difference in the size between those, the 140mm and the 120mm. The standard fans that are included in the case, as I said, are designed for airflow. They are vortex fans with the fins that are designed in a certain way to maximize the airflow through. And I did a video previously on the 5000D where I set it up just using the included fans, which weren't very many, alongside 360mm radiator, and actually found out that it basically got the same cooling as having 12 fans in there. So those fans are actually don't look like much, but they do a very good job of keeping the case really cool and running really well. Check that video out because it's quite interesting, I think. And obviously there's no RGB lighting on them, so potentially if you're not bothered about having RGB, those fans are really easy. Unfortunately, you can't purchase them separate though, which is a shame, because obviously having two fans on the front where you could have potentially have three, yeah, it feels like a missed opportunity and maybe an aesthetic problem that would certainly nag at me that it had a gap in it. But again, this is going to depend on your setup of it. And perhaps if you want to purchase the case and don't have enough money to buy all the fans immediately, then it's an option to just run it like that for a while until you do and then upgrade over time. So it's a nice option. So with the installation of that, basically, I'm just removing those 240mm fans and then setting up the ML120 RGB Pros with the cables facing in the same direction so I can make sure logically that everything's going to go the way I want it to. There are some nice notches cut out of the side along in various spots on the fan tray which make it really easy to recess the cables and run them into the rear. You'll also see as I'm going through that installation that there are holes in appropriate places in line with where those are going to go as well, so you can easily push the cables through from the front into the back. The fan tray itself is held in place with two screws on either side in the middle. Really easy to remove and to reinstall too. So if you ever need to take it off to give it a clean or whatever else, dead simple. And that sort of theme to the ease of installation and the ease of potential removing things in the future sort of goes through the entirety of this case. And you'll see that a lot as I'm building it and talking to you about it. It's a very simple setup. It does certainly get a lot more complicated when you're adding in the sheer number of cables that I am and with the multitude of fans, because these all need to be connected two different control boxes in order to get the RGB lighting working and the power working and ensuring that everything's running smoothly. And I did have some hiccups that hopefully you won't have if you watch this all the way through as I talk to you about what happened. But the end result is, once you've got those in place, obviously you can put the dust cover back on and that main front filter, and I'm happy to report there's no interference. With the 4000D, some people complained that there was a bit of interference from it, but I didn't have an issue. So going back to the Commander core, you can see a close-up of it here again. You'll note that you have the connections for the power and the RGB. It comes with some stickers that you can use. 3M stickers, basically stick it to the back of the case. So you need to find a good spot for where you're happy to install it. There isn't a great deal of space for installing this, especially when you see the other things that I end up installing on mine to get everything running as you'd want it to. Because I'm not installing any SSD drives, that gives me the option to install it on top of the cages, and in the end I decide to remove those entirely and not use them, and therefore that gives me even more space. There is potentially some room at the top, and maybe you could mount it on the CPU bracket or even on the door that closes, but basically the options are limited. The other thing that you need to be aware of is the sheer length of the cables. So you can see I'm setting it up, so I'm installing the RGB cable on one side, the power cable on the other, and trying to do it in sequence, and trying to get the sequence of all the fans to sort of match the AIO as well. As I said, they have 140mm fans on them, and I didn't want to mix and match, so there is potentially you could plug in the other fans into this control box as well. But obviously I'm going to end up with a heck of a lot of fans. I'm ending up with 9 ML120 fans in there and then the 3 other ones. So it does become a bit complicated. So to make life a bit easier, I have a Commander Pro that I happen to have on hand. A Commander Pro essentially acts as another fan hub. Unfortunately, it's not as good as the Commander Core in my mind because it doesn't have connections for RGB. What it does allow you to do is install 6 fans for power. It also has some RGB inputs for connecting RGB fan hubs, which I'll show you in a minute, and it works as a USB hub. So this allows me to install a number of other fans directly onto that, and apparently you can use splitters. There are all sorts of guides on the Corsair forums on how to set up the Commander Pro. If you have trouble, I'd recommend checking out the support forums in there, because there's loads of helpful people with plenty of guidance on there. But one of the things that I did find almost immediately is that these boxes weren't installed in a position that was fantastic, because the cables wouldn't particularly reach very well. So I ended up repositioning the Commander Core. So I'd recommend really thinking out where your cables are going to be and where your fans are and if they'll reach, because that is certainly a consideration when setting this up. So now I have the Commander Core, which I'm going to dedicate to the control of the fans on the rad, and the Commander Pro I'm going to use to set up the other fans. Obviously I have 8 fans on the front, so there's potentially a lot of fans to worry about there, and I'll talk to you a bit more about that. Then there's RGB hubs. There are different sorts of RGB hubs that you get with the triple packs of ML120 fans and with other Corsair fans. This one has a USB connection and a SATA power connection. The other ones that I'm going to use have a SATA power connection and then a connection that runs either to LED node or to the Commander Pro. You can see the LED node here that has 2 connections that would usually run from the RGB hub into that. And then it has a USB connection that goes to your motherboard and a SATA power connection that basically talks to IQ and lets it know that you have multitude of fans connected to an RGB fan hub and then connected to the LED. But what you can do is you can connect your fans up, the RGB connection of the fans to the RGB node and then straight into the Commander Pro. And that is actually how I ended up doing it, but I'll show you there's some complexities to that as we go through. You can see that this is quite complicated when you have this sheer number of fans. I think it's worth being aware that if you're thinking about buying this case and putting a hell of a lot of fans in it, you're going to have some difficulties. So here you can see one of the RGB hubs mounted at the top. You'll see that I have 4 fans installed on it, and there are 4 fans connected to it, and then one side there's another cable that comes out and runs down the channeling for SATA power, and on the other side the other RGB cable comes out and runs into the LED node at the moment, which is on the right hand side just above the Commander Pro, and that then has a USB connection into the Commander Pro, and that then has the USB connection into the motherboard. But what I actually ended up doing was running a cable straight from the RGB hub into the RGB LED connection on the Commander Pro, so you don't actually need the LED core. It's an option. Depends on what fans you're using, but in this case you didn't need it. Then I wanted another RGB fan hub at the bottom, and the reason that I have one at the top and one at the bottom is because once you've installed four fans on the side and the front, you'll soon find that the cables won't run. So for example, the cables from the bottom fans wouldn't reach the top rear of the case, and the cables from the top fans wouldn't reach the bottom of the case, and so on. I found that the best solution for me was to have an RGB hub at the bottom and one at the top, and then the power cables for most of the fans connect to the Commander Pro, but even they don't have enough length in them, although you do have extension cables. And so instead, what I actually ended up doing was using the PWM controller. So instead of having three standard fans connected to it, I actually connected the power cables from the RGB ML120 fans into that, and then the RGB to the RGB fan hub. And that PWM controller is fairly straightforward to set up because, as I said earlier in this video, it basically requires SATA power on one side, and then the other side connects to a system fan head on your motherboard. You need to check your motherboard manual to work out which one has PWM control, which allows you to adjust the speed of it with your motherboard software. But essentially that allows those fans to spin really easily, and it's dead easy to set up. And it has six inputs on it as well, so you can install six of the ML120 fans on that, at least the power side of it, and then plug the RGB into the RGB hub, which is included with the triple packs. And as I said, I mounted that at the top, so I end up with five fans with RGB connections on the top hub and four fans RGB connections on the bottom hub. But the difficulty becomes, usually what you would try and end up doing is having the RGB hub set up with your power connection, so Commander Pro for example, so that they run in sequence along the case. So for example, your bottom fan might be fan one, and that would go into the one connection on the RGB hub and the one connection on the power hub. Then the one above that would be two, and then three, and then four, and so on. And so if you have a sequence of RGB effects that you want to run throughout the case, you need to think about the logic of where that effect is going to start from. Maybe it starts from the bottom front and it goes all the way to the top of the case, then across the AIO, then down into the rear fan, and then up the side, or some other logic to it. And it really becomes complicated when you're trying to work out the sort of length of the cables, where these boxes are going to be placed, what sequence you're going to have those fans in, especially if you have them set on the front and the side like I'm going to, working out what the sequence would be for that. What I actually ended up doing was not worrying about that. Generally, I have my fans set to one color or one effect rather than something rippling through them. I like to just have a static color. I think that looks the nicest personally. It's a personal preference, but if you are thinking about having a sequence of effects and visual effects from the RGB lighting, it does become a lot more complicated. Now, as a placeholder, I actually have some Velcro ties. You see the yellow ones that I'm using. Basically, as I said, what I like to do, and what I'd highly recommend if this is your first time setting up a case, is to not use the plastic cable ties that are included in the box until you're sure that the fan connections are correct. Because one of the problems I found with this setup, obviously, is there's potential for getting them in the wrong order if you're worried about the effects, but also just not working properly. So when I initially turned the machine on, I found that three fans weren't spinning and five of them didn't have RGB. And the reason for that was actually really simple, thank goodness. One of the SATA power connections was slightly loose, and one of the other ones just wasn't plugged in, and there's so many SATA power connections. So here you can see what I was talking about earlier on, where I plugged the connection from the RGB hub into the LED node. You don't actually need to do that. Don't worry about that. If you have a Commander Pro, you can plug the connection from the RGB hub straight into the Commander Pro. The LED node would be used if you didn't have the Commander Pro, but then things are even more complicated because you've got to work out how you're going to power all the fans. You either need to use splitters or mix and match with the Commander Core, or plug them straight into the chassis fan headers on the motherboard. So with the sheer number of fans, things do become very complicated with the Corsair setup, unfortunately. If they were ML120 fans throughout, it might be a bit easier. But Corsair do recommend not mixing and matching fans. I didn't want to mix and match the size, different size fans on the Commander Core. I thought that might be bad. Now you can see that side fan setup again installs nicely on a tray, and then we're just making sure that the cables aren't in the way and that I can run them into the right direction. Again, this is held on with screws, so it's just a couple of screws that need re-screwing back into there, and then you've got to work out the cables. You can already see just how many cables are going on here. Now I have multiple control boxes, and I'm not even started looking at the power connections for the motherboard and the other things. If you have a lot of hard drives that are going in here, you're going to end up with a lot of cables too. But there are some nice channeling areas. You'll note, for example, there's one on the right-hand side that I haven't even used yet. And the main one that has the front panel connections that run down to the bottom of the case that I'm now running the 24-pin motherboard power supply unit cable up, that allows for a lot of the channeling of that as well, which makes it a lot easier. You can see I've temporarily stuffed the power supply cables down the bottom of the case too. But here we are a bit further on. Now we've got 8 fans installed on the front, 3 on the top on the radiator, and the 1 at the rear, and it's starting to come together now. It obviously is a lengthy process to get to this stage, and I think that installing the fans and getting the sequence of those connections correct is probably the most difficult thing about this case, but it certainly gives you a lot of flexibility. Now, a quick look at the installation of the motherboard and the setup of that. So I'm using a Zeus Pro Art B550 Creator motherboard. This was actually purchased by a friend. The setup is for him. I'm basically installing this motherboard. The Ryzen 95900X CPU, 32 gigabytes of XPG RAM, and an NVMe SSD from them as well. I'm going to be doing separate videos on. Quite a nice looking motherboard, but as I said earlier, this motherboard doesn't have 2 front panel USB connections. It has a single one, and it has the USB-C connection. And so it's slightly flawed for this case and for this build, because it means that not all the front panel connections are going to work, which is a real shame. But I do have RGB, both NVMe drives and RAM, which means a lot of RGB lighting going on in this case, and an overall pretty nice aesthetic as well. Nice bit of white and black and plenty of other things. Now, there are some nice things to say about this motherboard quickly. One is that it has 2 NVMe slots on it that you can see. The installation of the NVMe drives is really nice in here, because you don't actually need an M2 screw, which is a usual annoyance of NVMe setups. These new Asus motherboards actually have a little latch on them that holds the NVMe drive down. You can see it here. It basically just turns around and locks that drive into place. Very straightforward. This is an AMD setup, as I said, AMD CPU, which actually made the installation of the pump head a bit more fiddly, and certainly not as nice as Intel. It's been a long time since I've done an AMD build. This is the first one in quite some while, and I actually found that the CPU mount for the pump head is actually quite fiddly. You'll see there are some brackets both at top and below the CPU, which needs to hook over, and I had quite a fiddle trying to set that up, but the end result is pretty nice. Now, for the installation of the motherboard, there are already included standoffs installed on here, and obviously, being a full tower, it will take a full range of motherboards, and you can basically install mini ITX, micro ATX, ATX, and EATX motherboards in here. I imagine that installing a mini would be ridiculous, because it would be very tiny, but you can see that this motherboard just slotted straight into place. You didn't need to install any extra standoffs or anything like that. It's a really simple installation process, and in the box you have the included motherboard screws for screwing it down, and they are easy to do, easy to set up, and easy to install. There are also extra standoffs that I'll show you what they're for in a minute, that you can use for vertical mounting of your GPU and holding that in place if you want to as well. For reference, the case will have a PSU clearance of 225mm, the cooler is 190mm, and the GPU is up to 450mm. So fairly easy to sell. Now, for this H170i, there is an Intel bracket installed as standard. You can basically just pull that off with relative ease. You can see me just yanking it off there. You then need to install the AMD bracket if you're installing an AMD CPU, as I am, and so that it is in this position with those points sticking upwards. I found this really fiddly, I'll be honest, but you'll notice that the pump head has pre-applied thermal paste and keep that in mind for later on in the video when I talk about benchmarks. It then has these two clips which you then put in place, and you put the thumb screws on, and then they just hook over little lumps that stick out of the standard AMD brackets on the plastic on either side of the CPU. I found this process for installation to be really fiddly. What I'd recommend is minimizing the amount of screwage that you've put on these so that they're not very tight, and you can basically hook one side over and then the other. It was a real fiddle to get on, and certainly not as easy as Intel. And I've actually installed a different AIO in another build with the same AM4 socket that was a lot easier to install. So this Corsair one is a bit fiddly. And coming from installing multiple Corsair AIOs on Intel builds, I found it a lot easier before. But basically, you need to make sure you get that in a position where it will then hook over a little bit of plastic that juts out from the bottom, and then tighten those thumb screws down without over tightening them. And I'll show you a close up of that in a second. But it felt fairly fiddly and quite intimidating. But once it was on, it looks very nice. Now you can see the thumb screws here just slightly jutting out. There's a little bit of plastic underneath them that it hooks onto, and then that screws down. And the setup process beyond that is really straightforward as well, because basically there are two connections that come out of the pump head. One needs to connect to the CPU fan header on your motherboard, and the other one, which is the larger connection there, that plugs into the commander core. So you just need to run that cable to the back. Reference your motherboard for where the CPU fan header is, but usually it's in the top right. As you can see, I've just plugged it in there, so that's a little cable. Then you run the other one into the back, running that around the back, then that plugs in to the commander core. That's nice and long, so that gives you a bit more flexibility in terms of where you're going to install the commander core, so you don't have to put it where I have. You might want to put it somewhere else. But basically, I ran that cable through the channeling to keep things as neat as possible, and then plugged it in there. And you can only plug it in one way. You'll notice there's a little gray mark on it which shows you which way is the right way up, and instructions for installing it on there. Once you do that, that then allows the commander core to control the pump head, as long as you plug in the USB connection to your motherboard and the SATA power. That then has control, and IQ can then monitor temperatures and adjust flow and things like that. And this AIO setup is really good because it has a zero RPM mode, which means the fans won't spin unless they need to. But here you can see the problem that I have with the cables being at the front. So the option was either to mount the rad so it's facing the other way around and have the cables at the back, or to have those pump tubes run towards the front. What I found is that they're quite short and they won't go below the RAM, so I'm actually blocking some of the RGB on that, a point of interest. One other point though potentially is that I have a lot of intake fans pulling air from the front of which are then running over the tube, so that's potentially keeping it cooler. I don't know, but aesthetically it's worth thinking about which direction you're going to mount it in. Now there are also a lot of SATA power connections on here. The Commander Core, the Commander Pro need SATA power. You also need SATA power connections for the front panel and for the PWM controller. So if you're installing, make sure you put enough cables into your power supply unit to connect those flat SATA power connections. Make sure they're all connected before you power on, because that was a mistake I made. One of the connections was loose and the other one wasn't connected for the PWM controller, so not all the fans were spinning and not all the RGB was lighting up. I also ran some of the power cables from the power supply unit across on the right hand side. That is obviously for the CPU connections. This motherboard has an 8-pin and a 4-pin connection, which is incredibly fiddly to get in. I actually loathe this motherboard for its design because it has some very sharp corners on the heatsink on the top. But you can run those cables. You'll see there's absolutely loads of room to get cables through the top, even underneath that radiator, that large radiator. There's still plenty of room to run cables through there. Something that I found was a real fiddle on the 4000D and on the 5000D, but there's loads of room on the 7000, absolutely loads. So if you want a really easy build, this is the one to go for. The PWM controller I plugged into the system fan header, which you can just see here above the 24-pin. And then this is a USB-C connection that runs from the front panel. That obviously allows the front top panel. You can plug in your USB in there. And that's a fairly straightforward connection. And then just below that on this motherboard, and it's the same for most, is the other USB connection. Usually you'd want two of these. Unfortunately, there's only one on this one. But again, that's just a pretty simple connection once you've done that. Then you have the USB connections from the Commander Core and the Commander Pro, which then need to be connected to the bottom of your motherboard plugged into the USB header. Now, obviously, your setup may vary. You might not have a Commander Pro, for example. And if you don't use the same AI herb as me, you might not need that. But you won't get the Commander Pro or the Commander Core as standard, so it's worth bearing that in mind. You then have the front panel connections for the reset switch and the power switch. They're usually on the bottom right here. Refer to your motherboard manual to work out which way they install. Make sure that they're installed properly. Now I've got everything set up the way I want it for the most part, I go about the process of reinstalling that blanking plate at the front. I think this ends up making it look really clean because it blocks off that sort of power supply area, which, as you'll see in a second, there's quite a big mess on in terms of the setup. Now, the next thing I'm going to do is show you how to vertically mount your GPU. Now, you do need to purchase an additional thing here. There's a cable that you can buy, which allows you to connect it. But then inside the standard box for the case, you have some extra motherboard standoff screws that then screw into the bottom there. You can see they're basically near where I installed the SSD earlier on in the video. This cable from Corsair can then be used to vertically mount your GPU. It is worth noting that it only works with PCIe Gen 3 though, so it might limit your bandwidth if using an AMD motherboard and a new GPU as well. So although it's aesthetically nice, and I'm demonstrating for review purposes what you can do, you might not actually want to use this bracket. There are a limited number of PCIe 4 brackets and adapters that will allow you to run at maximum bandwidth. But this is how you'd go about that setup process. You're basically just screwing that down and holding it in place. You'll notice that there are three brackets on the right hand side near the glass tray that you can use to install a GPU now. I demonstrated previously with the 4000D and the 5000D a very similar setup for the installation of a GPU in this way. What I noticed when setting this case up was that this one looked like it gives you more room between where you'd set it up and the glass. This is going to vary depending on the size of your GPU. The one that I'm using is an RTX 2060 Super from Nvidia. It's the Founders Edition card. It's only two slots wide, so you can actually mount it further back and it doesn't obviously use that front one that's nearer the glass, which gives a nice big gap between the GPU and the glass, which potentially means that it runs cooler. And I have actually done the benchmarks with it in this position, and I'm going to do some other benchmarks in the near future to be able to compare the stats, because what I found with the previous cases was it ran about 10 degrees hotter than it did in the standard position. Included in the box, you also have an additional option which allows you to replace the standard horizontal usual mounts with another vertical mount that you can set further back, so you can actually put the GPU further back. It's not actually something I used, but it is included in the box and it shows you in the manual how to do it. So there are a multitude of options for mounting your GPU as well, which is really neat. It is certainly very nice to have it vertically mounted. And I think, although the 2060 Super isn't particularly big, it is a nice sort of way to show you just how huge this case is, because the GPU looks absolutely tiny, even mounted in this position. But it also runs cool, and it looks great. The airflow is obviously ridiculous as well, with that number of fans on the front, and the RGB is pretty magnificent too. The overall aesthetic, I think, is very nice. You could get even better RGB lighting if you were to use something like Corsair's QL120 fans that I did a video on previously in the Li Dynamic XL. And those things are better for RGB because they basically have RGB on both sides, whether you're intaking or exhausting. So the overall aesthetic is nicer. The MLs are better for cooling though, and this is an airflow case, so better cooling is obviously important. But you can see a close-up shot of the pump head here and the RGB lighting on that. All of this is adjustable within Corsair's IQ software. As long as you have it set up properly, you can customize the look of the fans and the pump head easily within that software and set up and choose from a number of different options. I'm not going to go into a great deal of depth on that here. I have covered it previously and I will talk about it a bit more on the AIO review, but obviously these ML120 fans aren't included as standard with this case. They are a separate purchase, so you won't actually have any RGB lighting unless you purchase these and go to town with them. But you can see the finished product certainly looks the business, and it's really easy to access the fans themselves, so if you want to clean them up in the future, Those dust trays are going to be particularly useful for keeping dirt and dust out of the case, is my experience with the previous cases and just overall Corsair cases. There's trays on the top and the bottom and the front and on the side panel at the back as well, where all the power cables are. So it makes it really easy. Obviously, as well, there's no thumb screws. And here's some more peely goodness for you, I did promise. Satisfying part of the build when you've finished and put it all together. And here's some shots for you to enjoy all my efforts. This took quite a long time to put together. I'm going to do a behind the scenes video on all the thought process that went into this if you're curious and want to watch that. But as you can see, a very nice looking case. It is obviously quite loud when all the fans are running at high speed, but one of the bonuses of this AIO is that you can set it so it runs at 0 RPM, which means those fans won't spin unless they need to, unless it needs to keep things cool. And overall, it is a very nice looking machine. So hopefully what you've seen from this video so far is there are a multitude of options in the way that you can set this case up. Obviously, I've gone to town with the fans, simply because they had fans from a previous build that I could do it, and I wanted to show the extent of what you can do. But you could go for a slightly different aesthetic. For example, you don't need to remove that side fan tray and install fans there. You might end up with the cable cover over the back instead, keeping it nice and neat and hiding away your cables a bit more. You might also opt for a multitude of hard drives or SSD drives being shown off and put into a position where they'd be cooled nicely. You might even have multiple radiator mounts and go for a full liquid cooling system. There's loads of different potential in here, but the point of it is it's very easy to set up the way you want it to, and there are a lot of things going for this case that make it simple both in the setup and overall maintenance of it, and the personalization of it. Because obviously you can set yours up differently to what other people might have. You don't have to copy what I've done, for example. You might go for more RGB rich fans like the QL fans from Corsair, or you might have less fans and just stick with the standard ones that are included in the box. It's another option. And so there's a lot going on here. Now, what I want to show is at the end, just the mess of cables that I have at the back here. I've tidied up quite a bit, as you can see, with these Velcro ties, and yet I've left a lot of mess still on purpose, because one of the best things about this case, and the same with the 5000D when I built that, is that you can put this cover on and mostly close it to hide away the shame of your cable management, and then we can just close that outer door and pretend that there's no mess back there at all. And it closed up nicely despite it not being super neat, and so now nobody knows, unless you've got this far in the video, just how messy the back of my case is, and yet it doesn't affect airflow. And airflow is another thing that's great, because as I've shown here and demonstrating, that GPU does sit quite a bit far back from the glass, which is great. This is not something you usually have with vertical mounting, but you can see you've got over an inch of gap between the fan and the glass. This is obviously going to vary. If you have a fatter card that's takes up three slots, then it's a bit of a problem. But you do have that other vertical mounting option. Although, personally, I'd suggest that a standard mounting is better if you want to keep your card running cool. But for aesthetic reasons, it certainly looks a lot nicer when put into that vertical position. The overall finished case also looks magnificent. You have a multitude of holes for all the airflow, and that is obviously the airflow case, and you are getting the best airflow possible from it, and then hopefully the temperatures to match. So once I set it up, because I'm also doing a video on the H170i, and because I wanted to test how the GPU would handle that vertical mounting and whether it got too hot, I set up and installed it on my usual desk, running on my favorite Samsung Odyssey G9 monitor, and I installed Cinebench, Heaven Benchmark, 3D Mark, and PC Mark, and I ran them all to put it through its paces and see how we got on. One of the things that I found was there was a problem initially with the CPU mounting, because running Cinebench actually got 90 degrees centigrade. And that is a bit hot even for an AMD CPU. So I ended up having to remount it and use Arctic Cooling Thermal Paste. I'm not sure whether it wasn't mounted properly or what, but basically it was running far too hot. With some new paste applied to it and with it remounted, I was getting about 70 degrees, so a lot cooler. I also found that the GPU ran surprisingly cool under pressure under a number of different tests. I'll leave all that data in the description as well as links to the 3D Mark and PC Mark tests so you can see it for yourself. But the end result is actually that the machine runs cool, and this is on the balanced profiles where you can set things to quiet or performance mode if you want to get even faster fans and an even cooler case. But the results were impressive and certainly pleasing after I'd reseated that CPU cooler. And you can see a close-up shot of the data straight from the dashboard within Corsair IQ software. IQ is great for this sort of thing. Allows you to see the overall temperature. You can see I'm running at 76 degrees C on the CPU. And that is under 100% load with Cinebench. But you can see that the fans aren't even spinning at maximum speed. And it isn't obnoxiously noisy, actually. You can hear the birds chirping in the background, so it shows it wasn't particularly loud. So there we have it, a really in-depth look at the Corsair 7000D Airflow. Let me know in the comments if you made it all the way to the end of this video. I appreciate it's been a very long one, but hopefully it's been in-depth enough to be incredibly useful to you. Let me know if there's any other questions you'd like to know the answer to. Be sure to check out the H170i video, and we'll hopefully be publishing alongside this one. And a quick shout out to all my special YouTube members who have clicked that join button to help support the channel. Those wonderful people include Meaty Keyboard, Raw, JShank007, Sir Spawns a Lot, Jeffrey Johnson, Kraken Tortoise, Beaster Bunny, Moist Kebab, and maybe even you. Thanks for taking the time to watch this video. Hope you enjoyed it. Have a great life. This has been the Provoked Prawn. Hope you found this video useful, interesting, hilarious, or otherwise. Take a look at these other videos that I think you might find interesting as well. And have a look at the description for links and other information you might find useful. Click that join button to see the benefits of being a member of my YouTube channel. And most importantly, have a great life.